Chapter 1, When Magic Ruled the World. My name is William Kankwaba, and to understand the story I'm about to tell, you must first understand the country that raised me. Malawi is a tiny nation in southeastern Africa. On a map, it appears like a flatworm burrowing its way through Zambia, Mozambique, and Tanzania, looking for a little room. Malawi is often called the warm heart of Africa, which says nothing about its location but everything about the people who call it home. The Kankuambas hail from the center of the country, from a tiny village called Mazitala, located on the outskirts of the town of Wimbe. You might be wondering what an African village looks like. Well, ours consists of about 10 houses, each one made of mud, bricks, and painted white. For most of my life, our roofs were made from long grasses that we pick near the swamps, or dembus in our Chikawa language. The grasses kept us cool in the hot months, but during the cold nights of winter, the frost creeps into our bones and we slept under an extra pile of blankets. Every house in Mazitala belongs to my large extended family of aunts and uncles and cousins. In our house, there was me, my mother and father, and my six sisters, along with some goats and gyna fowl, and a few chickens. When people hear I'm the only boy among six girls, they often say, "Ha, bamboo," which is like saying, "Hey man, so sorry for you." And it's true, the downside to having only sisters is that I often got bullied in school since I had no older brothers to protect me. And my sisters were always messing with my things. Especially with my tools and inventions, giving me no privacy. Whenever I asked my parents why do we have so many girls in the first place, I always got the same answer, because the baby store was all out of boys. But as you see in this story, my sisters are actually pretty great, and when you live on a farm, you need all of the help you can get. My family grew maize, which is another word for white corn. In our language, we lovingly refer to it as a chingamwa. And growing chingamwa required all hands. Every planting season, my sister and I would wake up before dawn to hoe the weeds and dig our careful rows. They push the seeds gently into the soft soil. When it came time to the harvest, we are busy again. Most families in Malawi are farmers. We live our entire lives out in the countryside, far away from cities, where we can tend our fields and raise our animals. Where we live, there are no computers or video games, very few televisions, and for most of my life, we didn't have electricity. Just oil lamps that spew smoke and coated our lungs with soot. Farmers here have always been poor, and not many can afford education. Seeing a doctor is also difficult, since most of us don't own cars. From the time we're born, we're given life with very few options. Because of this poverty and lack of knowledge, Malawis found help wherever we could. Many of us turned to magic, which is how my story begins. You see, before I discovered the miracles of science, I believed the magic ruled the world. Not magician magic like pulling rabbits out of hats or sawing ladies in half, the sort of thing you see on television. It was an invisible kind of magic, one that surrounds us like the air we breathe. In Malawi, magic came in many forms, the most common being the witch doctor, one we call Singanwa. The wizards were mysterious people. Some appear in public, usually market on Sundays, sitting on blankets spread with bones, spices, and powders that claim to cure everything from dandruff to cancer. Poor people walk many miles to visit this man, since they didn't have money for real doctors. This led to problems, especially if a person was truly sick. Take diarrhea, for example. Diarrhea is a common ailment in the countryside that comes from drinking dirt water. And if left untreated, it can lead to dehydration. Every year, too many children die from something that's usually cured by a regimen of fluids and simple antibiotics. But without money or faith in modern medicine, the villager takes his chance with the Sangawa crude diagnosis. "Oh, I know what's wrong," the wizard says. "You have a snail." "A snail? I'm almost positive. We must remove it at once." The wizard goes into his bag of roots, powders, and bombs and pulls out a light bulb. "Lift up your shirt," he says. Without plugging the bulb into anything, he moves it slowly across the person's stomach, and if to illuminate something only he can detect. There it is. Can you see the snail moving? Oh, yes. I think I can see it. Yes, there it is. The wizard returns to his bag for some magic potion, which is splashed across the valley. All better? He asks. Yeah, I think the snail is gone. I don't feel it moving. Good. That will be 3,000 kwacha. For a little extra money, the Singangwa can cast curses on your enemies to deliver floods to their fields, hyenas to their chicken house, or terror and tragedy into their homes. This is what happened to me when I was 6 years old, or at least I thought I did. I was playing in front of my house when a group of boys walking past carrying a giant sack. They worked for a nearby farmer tending his cows. That morning, as they were moving the herd from one pasture to another, they discovered a sack lying on the road. Looking inside, they saw that it was filled with bubble gum. Can you imagine such a treasure? I can't begin to tell you how much I love bubble gum. Now, as they walked past, one of them spotted me playing in the puddle. Should we give some to this boy? He asked. I didn't move or say a word. A bit of mud dripped from my hair. Ha! Why not? His friend said. He looks kind of pathetic. The boy reached into his bag and produced a rainbow of gumballs, one of every color, and dropped them to my hands. By the time the boys disappeared, I'd shoved every into my mouth. The sweet juices dripping down my chin and stained my shirt. Little did I know, but the bubble gum belonged to a local trader who stopped by our house next day. He told my father how the bag had dropped from his bicycle and he was leaving the market. By the time he circled back to look for it, the bag was gone. The people in the next village told him about the herd of boys. Now he wanted revenge. I've gone to see the Singangwa, he told my father, and whoever ate that bubble gum will be sorry. Finally, I was terrified. I've heard what Singangwa could do to a person. In addition to delivering death and disease, this wizard controlled armies of witches who could nap me during the night and shrink me into a worm. I'd never heard about them turning children to stones, leaving them to suffer eternity in silence. Already, I could feel the Singangwa watching me, plotting his evil. With my heart racing, I ran to the forest behind my house to try to escape, but I was no use. I felt the strange warmth of his magic eye shining through my theories. He had me. At any moment, I would emerge from the forest as a beetle, or a trembling mouse to be eaten by the hawks. Knowing my time was short, I hurried home to where my father was plucking a pile of maize and tumbling to his lap. It was me, I shouted, tears running down my cheeks. I ate the stolen gun. I don't want to die, Papa. Please, don't let them take me. My father looked at me for a second and shook his head. It was you? He said, then kind of smiled. Didn't he realize I was in trouble? Well, he said, and his knees popped as he rose from his chair. My father was a big man. Don't worry, William. I will find the trader and explain. I'm sure we can work something out. That afternoon, my father walked 5 miles to the trader's house and told him what had happened. And even though I'd only eaten a few of the gumballs, he paid the man for the entire bag, which was nearly all the money we possessed. That evening, after supper, my life having been saved, I asked my father if he truly believed I was in trouble. He became very serious. Oh yes, we were just in time, he said, then started laughing so hard his chair began to squeak. William, who knows what was in store for you? My fear of wizards and magic only grew worse whenever Grandpa told stories. If you saw my grandpa, you might think he was a kind of wizard himself. He was so old that he couldn't remember the year he'd been born. So cracked and wrinkled that his hands and feet looked as if they were chiseled from stone. And his clothes? Grandpa insisted on wearing the same tattered coat and trousers every day. Whenever he emerged from the forest, puffing on his brand-rolled cigar, you'd think one of the trees had grown legs and started walking. It was Grandpa who told me the greatest story about magic I've ever heard. Long ago, before the giant maize and tobacco farms came along and cleared away our great forest, when a person could lose track of the sun inside the trees, the land was rich with antelope, zebra, and wildebeest, also lions, hippos, and leopards. Grandpa was a famous hunter, so good with his bow and arrow that it became his duty to protect his village and provide its meat. One day, while Grandpa was out hunting, he came across a man who'd been killed by a poisonous pit viper. He alerted the nearest village, and soon after, they returned with their witch doctor. Singangwa took a look at the dead man, then reached into his bag and tossed some medicines into the trees. Seconds later, the earth began to move and as hundreds of vipers slithered out of the shadows and gathered around the corpse, hypnotized by the spell. The wizard then stood on the dead man's chest and drank a cup of potion, which seemed to flow through his feet and into the lifeless body. Then, to Grandpa's amazement, the dead man's fingers began to move and he sat up. Together, he and the wizard packed the fangs on its neck, looking for the one that had bitten him. "Believe it," Grandpa told me. "I saw this with my own eyes." I certainly believe it, along with every other story about witches and things unexplained. Whenever I went down the dark trails alone, my imagination spun wild. What scared me most were the Gulu and Kulu, the magical dancers that live in the murky shadows of the forest. They sometimes appear in the daylight, performing tribal ceremonies when we Chewa boys became men. They were not real people, we were told, but spirits of our dead ancestors sent to roam the earth. Their appearance was ghastly. Each had the face and skin of animals and some walk on stilts to appear taller. Once, I saw one scurrying back a pole like a spider, and when they danced, it was with 1,000 men were inside their bodies, each moving in the opposite direction. When the Gulu and Ku went performing, they traveled the forest and dambles looking for young boys to take back to the graveyard. What happened to you there, I never want to know. Whenever I saw one, even at a ceremony, I dropped everything and ran. Once, when I was very young, a magic dancer suddenly appeared in our courtyard. His head was wrapped in a flower sack, but underneath was the long nose of an elephant and a gaping hole for a mouth. My mother and father were in the field, so my sister and I ran for the bush, where we watched the dancers snatch our favorite chicken.
Espero que tenham gostado do vídeo. Se você chegou até aqui, muito obrigada por assistir. Curta o vídeo, inscreva-se no canal para receber mais conteúdos como esse. Um abraço, muita luz e fiquem com Deus.